This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Story of Burnt Njal from the Icelandic of the Njals Saga by Sir George Webbe Dasent. Prefatory note to the one-volume edition. Sir George Dasent's translation of the Njals Saga under the title The Story of Burnt Njal, which is reprinted in this volume, was published by Messrs. Edmonston and Douglas in 1861. That edition was in two volumes and was furnished by the author with maps and plans, with a lengthy introduction dealing with Iceland's history, religion, and social life, with an appendix and an exhaustive index. Copies of this edition can still be obtained from Mr. David Douglas of Edinburgh. The present reprint has been prepared in order that this incomparable saga may become accessible to those readers with whom a good story is the first consideration, and its bearing upon a nation's history a secondary one, or is not considered at all. For Burnt Njal may be approached either as a historical document or as a pure narrative of elemental natures, of strong passions, and of heroic feats of strength. Some of the best fighting in literature is to be found between its covers. Sir George Dasent's version, in its capacity as a learned work for the study, has had nearly 40 years of life. It is now offered afresh simply as a brave story for men who have been boys, and for boys who are going to be men. We lay down the book at the end, having added to our store of good memories the record of great deeds and great hearts, and to our gallery of heroes strong and admirable men worthy to stand beside the strong and admirable men of the Iliad, Gunnar of Lithend and Scarfadin, Njal and Kerry, Helgi and Kolskegg, beside Telamonian Aias and Patroclus, Achilles and Hector, Ulysses and Idomeneus. In two respects these Icelanders win more of our sympathy than the Greeks and Trojans, for they, like ourselves, are of northern blood, and in their mighty strivings are unassisted by the gods. In the present volume Sir George Dasent's preface has been shortened, and his introduction, which everyone who is interested in old Icelandic life and history should make a point of reading in the original edition, has been considerably abridged. The three appendices, treating of the Vikings, Queen Gunnhilda, and money and currency in the 10th century, have been also excised, and with them the index. There remains the saga itself, not a word of Sir George Dasent's simple, forcible, clean prose having been touched, with sufficient introductory matter to assist the reader to its fuller appreciation. Sir George Webbe Dasent, DCL, the translator of the Njals Saga, was born in 1817 at St. Vincent in the West Indies, of which island his father was Attorney General. He was educated at Westminster School and at Magdalen Hall, Oxford, where he was distinguished both as a fine athlete and a good classic. He took his degree in 1840, and on coming to London showed an early tendency towards literature and literary society. The Stirlings were connected with the island of St. Vincent, and as Dasent and John Stirling became close friends, he was a constant guest at Captain Stirling's house in Knightsbridge, which was frequented by many who afterwards rose to eminence in the world of letters, including Carlyle, to whom Dasent dedicated his first book, Dasent's appointment in 1842, as private secretary to Sir James Cartwright, the British envoy to the court of Sweden, took him to Stockholm, where under the advice of Jacob Grimm, whom he had met in Denmark, he began that study of Scandinavian literature which has enriched English literature BU the present work, and by the Norse tales, Gisli the Outlaw, and other valuable translations and memoirs. On settling in London again in 1845, he joined the Times staff as assistant editor to the great Delenn, who had been his friend at Oxford, and whose sister he married in the following year. Dasent retained the post during the paper's most brilliant period. In 1870, Mr. Gladstone offered him a civil service commissionership, which he accepted and held until his retirement in 1892, at which time he was the commission's official head. He was knighted for public services in 1876, having been created a knight of the Danish Order of the Danbrog many years earlier. In addition to his Scandinavian work, Sir George Dasent wrote several novels, of which The Annals of an Eventful Life was at once the most popular and the best. He died greatly respected in 1896. E.V. Lucas. Sir George Dasent's preface. Abridged. What is a saga? A saga is a story or telling in prose, sometimes mixed with verse. There are many kinds of sagas, of all degrees of truth. There are the mythical sagas, in which the wondrous deeds of heroes of old time, half-gods and half-men, as Sigurd and Ragnar, are told as they were handed down from father to son in the traditions of the northern race. Then there are sagas recounting the history of the kings of Norway and other countries, of the great line of Orkney Jarls, and of the chiefs who ruled in Faroe. These are all more or less trustworthy, and in general, far worthier of belief than much that passes for the early history of other races. Again, there are sagas relating to Iceland, narrating the lives and feuds and ends of mighty chiefs, the heads of the great families which dwelt in this or that district of the island. These were told by men who lived on the very spot, and told with a minuteness and exactness as to time and place that will bear the strictest examination. Such a saga is that of Njal, which we now lay before our readers in an English garb. Of all the sagas relating to Iceland, this tragic story bears away the palm for truthfulness and beauty. To use the words of one well qualified to judge, it is, as compared with all similar compositions, as gold to brass. Like all the sagas which relate to the same period of Icelandic story, Njala was not written down till about 100 years after the events which are described in it had happened. In the meantime, it was handed down by word of mouth, told from Althing to Althing at Spring Thing and Autumn Leet at all great gatherings of the people, and over many a fireside on sea strand or riverbank, or up among the dales and hills, by men who had learnt the sad story of Njal's fate, and who could tell of Gunnar's peerlessness and Hallgerda's infamy, of Bertora's helpfulness, of Skarfadin's hastiness, of Flosi's foul deed and Kurt's stern revenge. We may be sure that as soon as each event recorded in the saga occurred, it was told and talked about as matter of history, and when at last the whole story was unfolded and took shape and centered round Njal, that it was handed down from father to son as truthfully and faithfully as could ever be the case with any public or notorious matter in local history. But it is not on Njala alone that we have to rely for our evidence of its genuineness. There are many other sagas relating to the same period, and handed down in like manner, in which the actors in our saga are incidentally mentioned by name, and in which the deeds recorded of them are corroborated. They are mentioned also in songs and annals, the latter being the earliest written records which belong to the history of the island, while the former were more easily remembered from the construction of the verse. Much passes for history in other lands on far slighter grounds, and many a story in Thucydides or Tacitus, or even in Clarendon or Hume, is believed on evidence not one-tenth part so trustworthy as that which supports the narratives of these Icelandic storytellers of the 11th century. That with occurrences of undoubted truth and minute particularity as to time and place, as to dates and distance, are intermingled wild superstitions on several occasions, will startle no reader of the smallest judgment. All ages, our own not excepted, have their superstitions, and to suppose that a story told in the 11th century, when phantoms and ghosts and wraiths were implicitly believed in, and when dreams and warnings and tokens were part of every man's creed, should be wanting in these marks of genuineness, is simply to require that one great proof of its truthfulness should be wanting, and that in order to suit the spirit of our age, it should lack something which was part and parcel of popular belief in the age to which it belonged. To a thoughtful mind, therefore, such stories as that of Swan's witchcraft, Gunnar's song in his cairn, the wolf's ride before the burning, Flosi's dream, the signs and tokens before Brian's battle, and even Njal's weird foresight, on which the whole story hangs, will be regarded as proofs rather for than against its genuineness. But it is an old saying that a story never loses in telling, and so we may expect it must have been with this story. For the facts which the saga teller related, he was bound to follow the narrations of those who had gone before him, and if he swerved to or fro in this respect, public opinion and notorious fame was there to check and contradict him. But the way in which he told the facts was his own, and thus it comes that some sagas are better told than others, as the feeling and power of the narrator were above those of others. To tell a story truthfully was what was looked for from all men in those days, but to tell it properly and gracefully, and so to clothe the facts in fitting diction, was given to few, and of those few the saga teller who first threw Njala into its present shape was one of the first and foremost. With the change of faith and conversion of the Icelanders to Christianity, writing and the materials for writing first came into the land about the year 1000. There is no proof that the earlier or runic alphabet, which existed in heathen times, was ever used for any other purposes than those of simple monumental inscriptions or of short legends on weapons or sacrificial vessels or horns and drinking cups. But with the Roman alphabet came not only a readier means of expressing thought, but also a class of men who were wont thus to express themselves. Saga after saga was reduced to writing, and before the year 1200, it is reckoned that all the pieces of that kind of composition which relate to the history of Icelanders previous to the introduction of Christianity had passed from the oral into the written shape. Of all those sagas, none were so interesting as Njal, whether as regarded the length of the story, the number and rank of the chiefs who appeared in it as actors, and the graphic way in which the tragic tale was told. As a rounded whole, in which each part is finely and beautifully polished, in which the two great divisions of the story are kept in perfect balance and counterpoise, in which each person who appears is left free to speak in a way which stamps him with a character of his own, while all unite in working towards a common end, no saga had such claims on public attention as Njala, and it is certain none would sooner have been committed to writing. The latest period, therefore, that we can assign as the date at which our saga was molded into its present shape is the year 1200. It was a foster father's duty, in old times, to rear and cherish the child which he had taken from the arms of its natural parents, his superiors in rank. And so may this work, which the translator has taken from the house of Icelandic scholars, his masters in knowledge, and which he has reared and fostered so many years under an English roof, go forth and fight the battle of life for itself, and win fresh fame for those who gave it birth. It will be reward enough for him who has first clothed it in an English dress if his foster child adds another leaf to that evergreen wreath of glory which crowns the brows of Iceland's ancient worthies. Broad Sanctuary. Christmas Eve, 1860. It will be seen that in most cases the names of places throughout the saga have been turned into English, either in whole or in part, as Lithend for Elferendi and Bertorsnol for Bertorsval. The translator adopted this course to soften the ruggedness of the original names for the English reader, but in every case the Icelandic name with its English rendering will be found in the maps. The surnames and nicknames have also been turned into English, an attempt which has not a little increased the toil of translation. Great allowance must be made for these renderings, as those nicknames often arose out of circumstances of which we know little or nothing. Of some, such as Thorgeir Craggeir and Thorkel Foulmouth, the saga itself explains the origin. In a state of society where so many men bore the same name, any circumstance or event in a man's life, as well as any peculiarity in form or feature or in temper and turn of mind, gave rise to a surname or nickname, which clung to him through life as a distinguishing mark. The post office in the United States is said to give persons in the same district with similar names an initial of identification, which answers the same purpose as the Icelandic nickname, thus, John P. Smith, John Q. Smith. As a general rule, the translator has withstood the temptation to use old English words. Busk and bone he pleads guilty to, because both still linger in the language understood by few. Busk is a reflective form from eat bua sick, to get oneself ready, and bone is the past participle of the active form bua bin, to get ready. When the leader in old ballads says, busk ye my bonny bonny men, he calls on his followers to equip themselves. When they are thus equipped, they are bone. A bride busks herself for the bridal, when she is dressed she is bone. In old times a ship was busked for a voyage, when she was filled and ready for sea she was bone, whence come our outward bound and homeward bound. These with reeds for counsels or plans are almost the only words in the translation which are not still in everyday use. Sir George Dasent's Introduction. Abridged. The Northmen in Iceland. The men who colonized Iceland towards the end of the 9th century of the Christian era were of no savage or servile race. They fled from the overbearing power of the king, from that new and strange doctrine of government put forth by Harald Fairhair, 860-933, which made them the king's men at all times, instead of his only at certain times for special service, which laid scats and taxes on their lands, which interfered with vested rights and world-old laws, and allowed the monarch to meddle and make with the freeman's allodial holdings. As we look at it now, and from another point of view, we see that what to them was unbearable tyranny was really a step in the great march of civilization and progress, and that the centralization and consolidation of the royal authority, according to Charlemagne's system, was in time to be a blessing to the kingdoms of the north. but to the freeman it was a curse. He fought against it as long as he could, worsted over and over again, he renewed the struggle, and at last, when the isolated efforts, which were the keystone of his edifice of liberty, were fruitless, he sullenly withdrew from the field and left the land of his fathers, where, as he thought, no free-born man could now care to live. Now it is that we hear of him in Iceland, where Ingolf was the first settler in the year 874, and was soon followed by many of his countrymen. Now too we hear of him in all lands. Now France, now Italy, now Spain, feel the fury of his wrath and the weight of his arm. After a time, but not until nearly a century has passed, he spreads his wings for a wider flight and takes service under the great emperor at Byzantium, or Micklegarth, the great city, the town of towns, and fights his foes from whatever quarter they come. The Moslem in Sicily and Asia, the Bulgarians and Slavonians on the shores of the Black Sea and in Greece, well know the temper of the northern steel, which has forced many of their chosen champions to bite the dust. Wherever he goes, the Northman leaves his mark, and to this day the lion at the entrance to the arsenal at Venice is scored with runes which tell of his triumph. But of all countries, what were called the Western lands were his favorite haunt. England, where the Saxons were losing their old dash and daring, and settling down into a sluggish sensual race. Ireland, the flower of Celtic lands, in which a system of great age and undoubted civilization was then fast falling to pieces, afforded a tempting battlefield in the everlasting feuds between chief and chief. Scotland, where the power of the Picts was waning, while that of the Scots had not taken firm hold on the country, and most of all the islands in the Scottish Main, Orkney, Shetland, and the outlying Faroe Isles, all these were his chosen abode. In those islands he took deep root, established himself on the old system, shared in the quarrels of the chiefs and princes of the mainland, now helped Pict and now Scot, roved the seas and made all ships prizes, and kept alive his old grudge against Harold Fairhair and the new system by a long series of piratical incursions on the Norway coast. So worrying did these Viking cruises at last become, that Harold, who meantime had steadily pursued his policy at home, and forced all men to bow to his sway or leave the land, resolved to crush the wasps that stung him summer after summer in their own nest. First of all he sent Kettle Flatnose, a mighty chief, to subdue the foe, but though Kettle waged successful war, he kept what he won for himself. It was the old story of setting a thief to catch a thief, and Harold found that if he was to have his work done to his mind, he must do it himself. He called on his chiefs to follow him, levied a mighty force, and sailing suddenly with a fleet, which must have seemed an armada in those days, he fell upon the Vikings in Orkney and Shetland, in the Hebrides and Western Isles, in Man and Anglesey, in the Lewis and Faroe. Wherever he could find them he followed them up with fire and sword. Not once but twice he crossed the sea after them, and tore them out so thoroughly, root and branch, that we hear no more of these lands as a lair of Vikings, but as the abode of Norse jarls and their eudallers, freeholders, who look upon the new state of things at home as right and just, and acknowledge the authority of Harold and his successors by an allegiance more or less dutiful at different times, but which was never afterwards entirely thrown off. It was just then, just when the unflinching will of Harold had taught this stern lesson to his old foes, and arising in most part out of that lesson, that the great rush of settlers to Iceland took place. We have already seen that Ingolf and others had settled in Iceland from 874 downwards, but it was not until nearly 20 years afterwards that the island began to be thickly peopled. More than half of the names of the first colonists contained in the venerable land name a book, the Book of Lots, the Doomsday of Iceland, and far livelier reading than that of the conqueror, are those of Northmen who had been before settled in the British Isles. Our own country then was the great stepping stone between Norway and Iceland, and this one fact is enough to account for the close connection which the Icelanders ever afterwards kept up with their kinsmen who had remained behind in the islands of the West. Superstitions of the race. The Northmen had many superstitions. He believed in good giants and bad giants, in dark elves and bright elves, in superhuman beings who tilled the wide gulf which existed between himself and the gods. He believed too in wraiths and fetches and guardian spirits, who followed particular persons and belonged to certain families, a belief which seems to have sprung from the habit of regarding body and soul as two distinct beings, which at certain times took each a separate bodily shape. Sometimes the guardian spirit or phylgia took a human shape, at others its form took that of some animal fancied to foreshadow the character of the man to whom it belonged. Thus it becomes a bear, a wolf, an ox, and even a fox in men. the Fylgjur of women were fond of taking the shape of swans. To see one's own Fylgjur was unlucky, and often a sign that a man was fey or death-doomed. So when Thord Friedmundsson tells Njal that he sees the goat wallowing in its gore in the town of Bertorsnoll, the foresighted man tells him that he has seen his own Fylgjur, and that he must be doomed to die. Finer and nobler natures often saw the guardian spirits of others. Thus Njal saw the Fylgjur of Gunnar's enemies, which gave him no rest the livelong night, and his weird feeling is soon confirmed by the news brought by his shepherd. From the Fylgjur of the individual, it was easy to rise to the still more abstract notion of the guardian spirits of a family, who sometimes, if a great change in the house is about to begin, even show themselves as hurtful to some member of the house. He believed also that some men had more than one shape, that they could either take the shapes of animals, as bears or wolves, and so work mischief, or that without undergoing bodily change, an access of rage and strength came over them, and more especially towards night, which made them more than a match for ordinary men. Such men were called Hamramir, shape strong, and it was remarked that when the fit left them, they were weaker than they had been before. This gift was looked upon as something uncanny, and it leads us at once to another class of men, whose supernatural strength was regarded as a curse to the community. These were the Baresarks. What the Hamramir men were when they were in their fits, the Baresarks almost always were. They are described as being always of exceeding, and when their fury rose high, of superhuman strength. They too, like the Hamramir men, were very tired when the fits passed off. What led to their fits is hard to say. In the case of the only class of men like them nowadays, that of the Malays running amok, the intoxicating fumes of Bang or Eric are said to be the cause of their fury. One thing, however, is certain, that the Baresark, like his Malay brother, was looked upon as a public pest, and the mischief which they caused, relying partly no doubt on their natural strength, and partly on the hold which the belief in their supernatural nature had on the mind of the people, was such as to render their killing a good work. Again, the Northmen believed that certain men were fast or hard, that no weapons would touch them or wound their skin, that the mere glance of some men's eyes would turn the edge of the best sword, and that some persons had the power of withstanding poison. He believed in omens and dreams and warnings, in signs and wonders and tokens, he believed in good luck and bad luck, and that the man on whom fortune smiled or frowned bore the marks of her favor or displeasure on his face. He believed also in magic and sorcery, though he loathed them as unholy rites. With one of his beliefs our story has much to do, though this was a belief in good rather than in evil. He believed firmly that some men had the inborn gift, not won by any black arts, of seeing things and events beforehand. He believed, in short, in what is called in Scotland second sight. This was what was called being forespar or framson, foretelling and foresighted. Of such men it was said that their words could not be broken. Njal was one of these men, one of the wisest and at the same time most just and honorable of men. This gift ran in families, for Helgi Njal's son had it, and it was beyond a doubt one of the deepest rooted of all their superstitions. Social principles. Besides his creed and these beliefs, the new settler brought with him certain fixed social principles, which we shall do well to consider carefully in the outset. First and foremost came the father's right of property in his children. This right is common to the infancy of all communities, and exists before all law. We seek it in vain in codes which belong to a later period, but it has left traces of itself in all codes, and, abrogated in theory, still often exists in practice. We find it in the Roman law, and we find it among the Northmen. Thus it was the father's right to rear his children or not at his will. As soon as it was born, the child was laid upon the bare ground, and until the father came and looked at it, heard and saw that it was strong in lung and limb, lifted it in his arms and handed it over to the women to be reared, its fate hung in the balance, and life or death depended on the sentence of its sire. After it had passed safely through that ordeal, it was duly washed, signed with Thor's holy hammer, and solemnly received into the family. If it were a weakly boy, and still more often if it were a girl, no matter whether she were strong or weak, the infant was exposed to die by ravening beasts or the inclemency of the climate. Many instances occur of children so exposed, who, saved by some kindly neighbor and fostered beneath a stranger's roof, thus contracted ties reckoned still more binding than blood itself. So long as his children remained under his roof, they were their father's own. When the sons left the paternal roof, they were emancipated, and when the daughters were married, they were also free. but the marriage itself remained till the latest times a matter of sale and barter in deed as well as name. The wife came into the house in the patriarchal state, either stolen or bought from her nearest male relations, and though in later times when the sale took place it was softened by settling part of the dower and portion on the wife, we shall do well to bear in mind that originally dower was only the price paid by the suitor to the father for his goodwill, while portion, on the other hand, was the sum paid by the father to persuade a suitor to take a daughter off his hands. Let us remember, therefore, that in those times, as Odin was supreme in Asgard as the great father of gods and men, so in his own house every father of the race that revered Odin was also sovereign and supreme. In the second place, as the creed of the race was one that adored the great father as the god of battles, as it was his will that turned the fight, nay, as that was the very way in which he chose to call his own to himself, it followed that any appeal to arms was looked upon as an appeal to God. Victory was indeed the sign of a rightful cause, and he that won the day remained behind to enjoy the rights which he had won in fair fight, but he that lost it, if he fell bravely and like a man, if he truly believed his quarrel just and brought it without guile to the issue of the sword, went by the very manner of his death to a better place. The father of the slain wanted him, and he was welcomed by the Valkyries, by Odin's course choosers, to the festive board in Valhalla. In every point of view, therefore, war and battle was a holy thing, and the Northmen went to the battlefield in the firm conviction that right would prevail. In modern times, while we appeal in declarations of war to the god of battles, we do it with the feeling that war is often an unholy thing, and that Providence is not always on the side of strong battalions. The Northmen saw Providence on both sides. It was good to live if one fought bravely, but it was also good to die if one fell bravely. To live bravely and to die bravely, trusting in the god of battles, was the warrior's comfortable creed. But this feeling was also shown in private life. When two tribes or peoples rushed to war, there Odin, the warrior's god, was sure to be busy in the fight, turning the day this way or that at his will. But he was no less present in private war, where in any quarrel man met man to claim or to defend a right. There too, he turned the scale and swayed the day, and there too an appeal to arms was regarded as an appeal to heaven. Hence arose another right older than all law, the right of duel, of wager of battle, as the old English law called it. Among the Northmen it underlaid all their early legislation, which, as we shall see, aimed rather at regulating and guiding it, by making it a part and parcel of the law, than at attempting to check at once a custom which had grown up with the whole faith of the people, and which was regarded as a right at once so time-honored and so holy. Thirdly, we must never forget that, as it is the Christian's duty to forgive his foes, and to be patient and long-suffering under the most grievous wrongs, so it was the heathen's bounden duty to avenge all wrongs, and most of all those offered to blood relations, to his kith and kin, to the utmost limit of his power. Hence arose the constant blood feuds between families, of which we shall hear so much in our story, but which we shall fail fully to understand, unless we keep in view, along with this duty of revenge, the right or property which all heads of houses had in their relations. Out of these twofold rights, of the right of revenge and the right of property, arose that strange medley of forbearance and bloodthirstiness which stamps the age. Revenge was a duty and a right, but property was no less a right, and so it rested with the father of a family either to take revenge, life for life, or to forego his vengeance, and take a compensation in goods or money for the loss he had sustained in his property. Out of this latter view arose those arbitrary tariffs for wounds or loss of life, which were gradually developed more or less completely in all the Teutonic and Scandinavian races, until every injury to life or limb had its proportionate price according to the rank which the injured person bore in the social scale. These tariffs, settled by the heads of houses, are in fact the first elements of the law of nations, but it must be clearly understood that it always rested with the injured family, either to follow up the quarrel by private war, or to call on the man who had inflicted the injury to pay a fitting fine. If he refused, the feud might be followed up on the battlefield, in the earliest times or in later days, either by battle or by law. Of the latter mode of proceeding, we shall have to speak at greater length farther on. For the present, we content ourselves with indicating these different modes of settling a quarrel in what we have called the patriarchal state. A fourth great principle of his nature was the conviction of the worthlessness and fleeting nature of all worldly goods. One thing alone was firm and unshaken, the stability of well-earned fame. Goods perish, friends perish, a man himself perishes, but fame never dies to him that hath won it worthily. One thing I know that never dies, the judgment passed on every mortal man.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.